going to show a lot of these results. And I'm going to show numerical simulations, and Malcolm did this numerical simulation. And at the end of the talk, if I still have time, I will try to show some results we obtained with Andres related to the problem of coupling between surface and body waves. But first, I'm going to give some introductory ideas. So, as you know, planetary seismology is a large N seismology, where N is the number of scientists per megabytes of data. yeah, because indeed we had arrays on the Moon, but four stations. And on Mars, we have a super high density of stations because we have two stations within a few centimeters. No, I'm just kidding. So indeed, we are working with very few data. Difficult data, and I'm going to show you what we try to do with it. And in particular, I will discuss some results obtained in the framework of the InSight mission. So this is this mission that landed in November 2018, and which deployed a suite of geophysical instruments, and in particular, two seismometers actually. I will mostly, or almost exclusively, show results we obtained with the very broadband seismometer that was designed at IPGP in Paris. But there is another excellent seismometer that was developed by people at Imperial College in London, which is so the difference between the two instruments is the frequency band. The VBB goes down to I think 40 or 50 seconds period, maybe even lower, and up to tens of 10 hertz. And the ESP, the frequency band is between 2 to how many hertz you want? I mean, kilohertz probably. And so the first thing that is important and why I like planetary seismology is because you have a super large variety of propagation regimes. So from the Earth, where you have this, from the Earth, where we have this beautiful ballistic waves we can use to do seismic tomography and produce these 3D images. And on the opposite side, you have the Moon with this super long leaf codas and these diffuse signals, so totally different propagation regime, and that tells us something about the internal structure of these bodies. And you will see probably intermediate between the two, we have Mars with some ballistic waves, not so many, a lot of scattering, and I will try to explain to you what we do with this data. But first, I'm going to give you some general ideas. So of course, what changes the most in between the different planets is not so much the wave speed. I mean, if you take the average wave speed in the crust of Mars, it's not so different from the one of the Moon or the one in the Earth. But what changes a lot is the attenuation properties, and this is the field in which I work on. So it's great for me. And so attenuation is really an important component for many aspects of seismology, in particular on the Earth for seismic risk evaluation. And basically, attenuation occurs at scales that, in general, you do not see in seismic tomography. So seismic tomography, classical seismic tomography based on travel time, or even waveform tomography, they produce some smooth images like this one. Okay. But actually, these do not represent the full complexity. And in particular, I will show you evidence that if you zoom in, for example, this low anomaly, inside this low anomaly, you will see small scale variations, okay, that are not detected by the classical data analysis, okay. And so we can have many types of fluctuations. We can have continuous fluctuation. And we see them, for example, in borehole data. I will give you examples. But in the case of the close to the surface of bodies like the Moon or Mars, we have a lot of porosity with faults and cracks. And for example, one of the questions we are being asked by our colleagues is, can you tell me what is the thickness of the porosity at the surface of the moon? Or can you tell me the thickness of the porosity at the surface of Mars? Okay, because this has implications, for example, for the interpretation of the gravity field. Okay, so we are solicited to produce models from which we can try to answer this type of questions. Okay. So all these things, okay, this small-scale fluctuation of elastic parameters, they will contribute to what we call the scattering attenuation. Okay, and I will show you example of scattering and discuss a lot, or try to discuss to some extent this term here. But there is another very important attenuation mechanism, which I call absorption, which in fact covers many different types of phenomena. And probably the most important process for planetary science is the absorption due to the presence of fluids inside the porosity. So, of course, you're going to tell me, but there is no fluid on the moon. Yeah, certainly there is no free water. But there have been some very important experiments that have been done in the framework of the Apollo mission by a guy called Tittmann. And in fact, when the samples, the lunar samples, were brought back on Earth, okay, and people did the first measurements of attenuation, and these were not bad people. Huh? I think this was there were paper published by Kanamori, who said that the Q of the Moon was 100. So 100, to tell you the true value, the Q of the Moon is thousands. Okay, so it was an error by a factor of 10. And people realized that it didn't match with the super long duration of the data, so there was an issue. And actually, it's Tittmann who understood that the reason for this totally wrong measurement was just the moisture present in the air of the laboratory. And this has been a very important discovery. It's just the adsorption of one layer of cation, of hydrogen, at the surface of minerals suffices to drop the quality factor of the rocks by a factor of 10, okay? And he made some very beautiful experiment where he took Earth basalt, put them in oven, heated them. So by heating them, he completely cracked these materials, okay? So it's interesting because at the same time as he was degassing the rock, he was also making it much more compressible. So he was generating a large amount of cracks, okay? But in spite of that, the dissipation was clearly decreasing, okay, because just it was removing all the water or the volatile that were present in the rock, okay. So of course, one of the motivations for studying the attenuation on Mars is to determine if there can be some water. When I say water again, it's think of films of absorb cation, okay, the surface of mineral, okay. And this is not necessarily easy because it is so that there cannot be free water in the near surface, but there can be ice. There is ice; it has been observed. Okay, and we can imagine that at depth, this ice turns into water. So, if we want to detect some water in the crust of Mars, we have to be able to detect an absorbing layer at depth, which is not so easy. Okay, so just to give you, the motivation of why scattering and attenuation can be interesting for planetary science. And there are many other interesting questions about the moon, the relation between the deep seismicity of the moon and the seismic attenuation, the presence of volatile at depth in the moon. So there are many interesting things. I'm not going to spend more time on that. And I will go to the hardcore part of my talk, which is not so difficult. But this is just to give you some introductory idea about scattering. So I will begin with some simple things. Single scattering. Okay, single scattering means we have an isolated object somewhere in the medium which is otherwise homogeneous. Okay, and I will make many simplifying assumptions to make the things as simple as possible. So I will start with an object. The dimension of this object, I call it A, okay? You can think of a sphere, for example, with a radius A, and whose size is much smaller than the wavelength, okay? So the long wavelengths, okay? So small object, looks like a point, okay? And what if you open a book of mathematics, okay, you will see that scattering is this, okay? So you have a free mode, okay, of your equation, so plane wave, okay, that comes in, okay. And then in the far field, you will see an outgoing spherical wave, okay. Also here I write everything in three dimension, okay, so it changes depending on the dimension. And an interesting feature is that we have this quantity here that is called the scattering amplitude, okay, for good reasons, because it describes the amplitude of this spherical scattered wave. And the scattering amplitude is a function of the incident wave and the scattered wave. So in seismology, we are dealing with elastic waves, so I should put vector indices everywhere here. Okay, I'm not going to do it, so I will proceed as if everything was acoustic. But I think what I'm going to say, I'm talking about the control of people in the audience who know this much better than that. I think it's probably also true for acoustic waves. So in the case of elastic waves, in addition, you will have in fact two outgoing waves. Huh, okay, you will have an outgoing P wave and an outgoing S wave. Okay, so but I think okay, we can generalize that. But I will keep this simple formulation. The first thing that is quite interesting, so from a practical point of view, I will try to tell you what we can hope to find when we look at scattering. Okay, so the first interesting thing, and this is something that was pointed out by Wu and Aki a long time ago, and this is the decomposition is really true only for objects which have small perturbation with respect to the background medium, okay? But what they said, what they showed, in fact, is that there are two n-member type of perturbation. They have what they call velocity perturbation. So basically, when this object has a contrast, it can have a contrast of both impedance. So impedance is defined as the product of the density rho and the wave speed, okay? And an independent variation of velocity. Okay, so you can decompose the fluctuation into two terms, okay, impedance contrast and velocity contrast. And the interesting thing is that these two types of perturbation, they give completely different scattering patterns. So this is what you obtain in the velocity perturbation. So there is no impedance contrast. So basically what you get is just some kind of deflection of the rays. Okay? And this is what you see here. You have a little bit of backscattering, but you have this is a polar diagram, and that shows this quantity here, and this is a picture of the scattering amplitude. And so it depends on, of course, your incident wave is coming in this direction, and we look at how much energy is scattered in any given direction of space. Okay, so here it's a 2D representation, but you can imagine we could do a 3D, but okay, simpler in 2D. And so for a velocity perturbation, okay, you have this large lobe of forward scattering. Okay. By contrast, if you don't perturb the velocity, just the impedance, okay, so you keep C constant, but you perturb rho C, okay, then you get this large lobe of backward scattering. So already it's interesting. So that characterizes, in fact, the changes you have in the medium. Okay. And so this is a first lesson that you can learn, is that if you are able to access this quantity, which is difficult, we will see, then you can start to have an idea of the type of fluctuations that occur in the medium. Okay. Okay. This is the first important idea. And for later use, I will introduce a parameter which I call G. Okay. Here. And this parameter is just a way of quantifying the amount of scattering anisotropy we have. Okay, so as you can see, this is just this is the cosine of the scattering angle. Okay, so you have k here, r here. So k dot r is the cosine of the scattering angle. Here, this is the modulus square of the scattering amplitude. So this is proportional to the energy, the amount of energy that is scattered in the direction r. Okay, and I could just compute the weighted average of the cosine of the scattering angle. Okay, so this is a quantity that can vary between -1 and 1, like a cosine. Okay, and if you have a preferentially forward scattering, G will be positive, and if you have preferentially backward scattering, G will be negative. Okay. If you have questions, interrupt me. So of course, In the Earth, in general, we rarely have only perturbation of density, perturbation of velocity. But we have some ideas of the type of correlation we have between the two. And small objects, in general, in the Earth, will produce a large lobe of backward scattering with possibly some more complicated pattern, which you obtain by just making a combination, linear combination, of impedance and velocity perturbation. Once again, this decomposition is valid only if the perturbations are weak enough. Okay, I'm not going to talk at all about what happens when the properties are strongly different, and then you can there is a whole suite of interesting phenomena like giant resonances and stuff like that. I'm not going to discuss this, but it could be interesting, for example, for Nicolai for the case of volcanoes. But I'm not going to discuss this today. Now, what happens when the object has the finite size, and when I say finite size, it's compared to the wavelength. So, one very convenient approximation we can use, and we can think of a finite object as a collection of small objects. Okay, and so basically, by just summing the contribution of each elementary volume of the object, you can build up the scattering amplitude, okay, for a finite size object by integrating over the volume of your big object, okay. And in physics, this is what people call the Relegance approximation, okay. And it is very nice because it's easy and it gives us a lot of insight about what happens when we enter in this regime where the object has a finite size compared to the wavelength. In seismology, we call it the Born approximation, which is okay, this is the terminology we use. Indeed, it's related to the Born approximation. One problem is that there are many different Born approximations, in fact, in scattering theory, and they don't mean the same thing. So, Relegance approximation is a good thing. And if you want to know more, you can go to the physics literature, and you can explore, and you will see. If you want to dive into this type of things, you will find the Relegance approximation and many more approximations if you want. So I think I explained the idea of the Relegance approximation and what it gives rise to. It gives rise to, so we, here we retrieve this function here, which depends on the perturbation, which I've shown previously. And now we have an additional factor, which is called the structure factor. Okay, and the structure factor, what is it? This is just the Fourier transform of the characteristics function of your scatterer. So the characteristic function is a function which is, I imagine a simple object. The properties that change, that they are homogeneous inside the object, okay, and different from what we have outside the object. And so in this case, we have here the characteristic function of the scatterer is a function which equals 1 when you are inside the scatterer and 0 when you are outside. Okay, so that describes the shape of your object. And the structure factor is just the Fourier transform. So here I write it in 3D. Of this function which describes the shape of the object. And here I'm showing what it looks like for a sphere. Very simple, okay? And so here I'm showing the modulus squared as a function of a size parameter. So here you have the product of P, this wave number here, because we are now in the Fourier domain, and A, which is, as you remember, the radius of my sphere, okay? And you see that there is basically a plateau for small wave number or small adimensional parameter P times A, and then a sharp drop off basically when the wave number here, P, okay, starts to be of the order of the size of the object. And what this does, okay, this is going to introduce a cutoff in the scattering angle. Okay, so as you can see here, when we do a scattering experiment, in fact, we are looking at the structure factor for different value of this parameter PA. Okay, so if you are at low frequency, so maybe I should say something. When you are looking at scattering in the exact forward direction, okay, you have K equals R, so then P equals 0, you are here. Okay. Now, when you are looking in opposite direction, okay, so when K and R are in opposite direction, in fact, you will be somewhere here on this axis, okay, on the x-axis, and where you are depends on the ratio between the wavelengths and the size of the object. So for long wavelengths, you will only see this flat part of the spectrum between 0 and 2 times the wave number of your incident wave. Okay? The 2 comes from the fact that when you add the two wave numbers, well, you get a factor of 2. Okay? I guess you understand that. And so for long wavelengths, you don't see the structure factor, in fact. So this is why it was not in the previous formula, okay? Because you only see this part. And now, when the wavelength decreases, you will see at larger and larger wave numbers here, or non-dimensional parameter, and you will see this drop of the structure factor. And what it does, in effect, it cuts off the large scattering angle. Okay, so the message is that when you have objects that start to be of the size of your scatterer, you will have lobe of forward scattering that will develop and that will erase, in fact, and here this is the same general perturbation that I had on the previous slide, okay? But because of the cutoff introduced by the structure factor, we completely lose the backward scattering and we only see the scattering in the forward direction. So that's another message. That means that you cannot resolve all types of perturbation at all frequencies, okay? So if you want to know the properties of your object, you have to scan it at low frequency, higher frequencies, and the higher frequencies then will tell you something about the size distribution, okay? So you gain, you lose on one side, but you gain on the other. It is here, based on the size, in fact, of this lobe, you can determine the size of the object, okay? And if you then you can look at lower frequency, you can determine the nature of the object, okay? So here I try to summarize this different frequency regime in a diagram. So to do that, I will introduce a very important quantity in scattering theory for single scattering, which is the scattering cross-section. So I call it here scattering efficacy. But so basically, it's a surface. Huh? It's just, and it's not very complicated to understand what it is. So basically, it's the ratio between the total scattered energy so that you can measure in all directions in the far field. So you integrate the complete field on the sphere, and you compute the flux, and you get the energy that flows away as scattered wave, okay, per unit time. And you take the ratio of this energy with just the incident flux, okay? So the incident flux, which is the energy brought by the incident wave per unit time, per unit surface. And this gives you a surface, okay, which measures the size of this surface. You can think of it that if your scatterer was absorbing everything, this would be the equivalent surface of this absorber. Okay, but okay, just say it's a surface, and the size of this surface measures the efficacy of the scattering. And you can see that it varies a lot depending on the size of the object. Okay, so here you have a non-dimensional frequency. So this is the product of the incident wave number and the size of the object. And here you have the value of the scattering cross-section, and it's a log-log plot. Hein? So here you have something like 5 orders of magnitude, and here you have almost 10 orders of magnitude. Okay, so it varies drastically. And what is interesting, you see that there are different frequency regimes. So in the long wavelengths case, which we call the Rayleigh regime, the scattering cross-section increases, so in 3 dimensions, hein? Like the force power of the frequency. Then when we enter into the regime where you are forward scattering, and in the literature it has a weird name, it's called stochastic. There's nothing stochastic there, but this is for historical reason. You have a transition to an omega square dependence, okay? And eventually you will reach a saturation regime, which is called the geometric regime. And in the geometric regime, the efficacy of the scattering is totally independent, or almost completely dependent, of the nature of the object. It goes to a value which is just twice the geometrical area of the object. And we could spend some time explaining why it's 2. But basically, the idea is that you have 2 effects, okay? At high frequency, so you have to take the ray picture. So if you have an anomaly, you will have a part of the wavefront which will the rays which will touch the anomaly, they will be diffracted, okay, or refracted. So that will disrupt an area which is the area of the object, pa squared, okay. But then, in a sense, you are leaving a hole in the wavefront, okay. And that will entail some additional diffraction by edge rays, okay. They will want to fill in this disrupted part of the wavefront, okay. And you can show that this diffraction effect has exactly the same magnitude as the effect of the leaving the hole inside the object. I don't know if I've been clear, okay. But that, but we can. There are simple ways of computing this. You can do it with the ray approximation, okay. And you will find that in the geometric regime you have this simple result, okay. But the important point is that you see that attenuation cannot increase forever, okay. It saturates, and we know the saturation value, okay. And it's independent of the nature of the object. It's quite universal. Actually, it's not totally true, but. So, okay, so now that we have all these things in mind, I want to. So far, I've discussed the simplest problem, single scattering, okay, it's already complicated. But it's totally unrealistic for us. Hein? I mean, in the case of the Earth, so we don't have isolated objects, inhomogeneous. We have a lot of heterogeneity. And I want to say give a few general ideas about heterogeneity in the Earth. And I'm not going to discuss about what can happen really in the very near surface where it's total mess, like for example in volcanoes. I think what I will say will apply mostly to when you are in the crust, okay, at some depths, okay, here already you see you are at 600 meters, okay, so there is a lot of garbage above, and which is very complicated, and we don't know how to deal with it. But I think this is an example of what you measure when you do boreholes. And you access here this is the P wave velocity, S wave velocity, and the density. And so you can see different things, and you can see that there are layers, okay, so this you know, okay. But what is interesting is that inside each layer you have fluctuations. Okay? And it's quite ubiquitous, okay. You never see constant, even though the rock looks homogeneous, more or less. Well, in fact, the elastic parameters fluctuate, okay? And as I will show you, it fluctuates at all scales, okay? So this is the example of the type of measurement we have. So here, these are correlation diagrams for different parameters. So here, this is the P wave velocity and the density. Here, the shear wave velocity density. And here, the two velocities. And so this type of information are important because they show that based on the discussion we have, the density and the velocity, they do not vary independently. In fact, they are strongly correlated. So basically, P and S wave velocities are usually positively correlated, and the same for the shear velocity, P velocity, and the density. And that is interesting also from the point of view of scattering theory, because we have three parameters that can vary independently, and when we consider multiple scattering, we have to take into account the as Jocelyn explained yesterday, we have to take into account the correlation of parameters, okay, and that reduces, in fact, the dimension of the problem. So these are important information, and so the way we have these fluctuations, and the way we characterize them is through a statistical descriptor, which is a correlation function. So basically, you're just taking the correlation of two measurements of the velocity at two different points. And we can estimate this correlation function from this type of borehole measurements, okay? And we can try to extrapolate them to three dimensions, okay? And so, in fact, this correlation function in the multiple scattering theory, which I'm going to discuss next, plays the same role as the shape of the object, okay? This will describe basically the shape of the basic entity that produces the scattering. Okay. Now, as you have seen in the single scattering case, it's not so much the shape factor that matters, but it's Fourier transform. It's the same in the multiple scattering case. Okay. And so this is I'm showing here the Fourier transform of the correlation function. Okay, I'm using here the same notation, so it's not the shape factor, no, it's what we call the power spectrum of heterogeneity. But it has exactly the same function, the same role in the multiple scattering theory. Okay, so this is why I'm using the same notation. And this is a very nice compilation of measurement at different scales. So this work that's been done by Sato. And here you have, for example, what people have been able to infer about the fluctuation of velocities in rock. So granite, okay, for different type measurement, VSVP. And you see basically that this power spectrum has this shape, okay, with the plateau at a small wave number. So this is the wave number, okay. So basically, small objects are here, large objects are here, okay. And the cutoff here is the typical size. So if you're in a rock, it's probably the typical size of the grains of the minerals in the rock, okay. So this is where this is the inverse size of your minerals, okay. And you see that so you have this plateau here, a small wave number, and then this power law behavior with the slope, which is something between 3 and 4. Okay, so 4, in fact, it's some very well-known process. It's the exponential correlation. Okay, so when this function is an exponential, okay, so in general, this function will not depend on x, it will only depend on r, or at least we hope so. Or if it depends on x, it depends slowly on x. So when here it's an exponential dependence on r, then this gives this power law decay with a slope 4, okay? And so basically, all this type of power spectra, they can be summarized in this formula that we have here, okay? But I'll come back to it. So this is what you see in rocks, but in borehole, you see this, okay? And so two remarks. First of all, you see that depending on the size of the sample you have, you see different correlation lengths. Okay. Here you have this correlation length. Here you have this correlation length. So what that means? That means that in fact the correlation length certainly depends on the size of the object you are looking at. Okay. So to me that means that it's not necessarily a super well defined quantity. It depends on the way you sample your medium, okay. But the lesson that personally I learned from that is that basically we have heterogeneities at all scale, and that these heterogeneities can be well described by this simple power law spectra, okay. So personally, I don't attach a lot of importance to what the correlation is, but I do attach a lot of importance to the slope of the power spectrum. I think this is something interesting. And the universality of this law here is quite interesting and important for us, I think. Okay, so mathematically, this type of dependence can be summarized in this formula, okay, where you have here the correlation length. So again, keep in mind that the correlation length might depend a lot on the way you look at the object, okay, and not necessarily on the object itself. And then we have this what we call the Hurst exponent, which basically controls the decay here of the power spectrum. So basically, if you have a smaller Hurst exponent, you will have a lot of small scales in the medium. If you have a large Hurst exponent, you will cut off the small scale, and the medium will look smoother. So just to give you an example, okay, this is the Gaussian medium. Absolutely of no interest to us, I think. We never see Gaussian media in the real Earth, okay? And these are these von Kalman media, so basically the one I just showed, okay, with different value of the Hurst exponent. So and you see that as you increase the Hurst exponent, the medium looks smoother and smoother. So here, all these media have the same correlation distance. Okay, you can see it, the size of a blob. So it's the size of the largest inhomogeneity. And because of this power law spectrum, on top of this large scale fluctuation, you have a lot of small scales, and the amount of small scale is controlled by this von Karman exponent. Okay. And of course, this is going to control the way the scattering proceeds. So I arrive now at the multiple scattering. So in fact, multiple scattering is what happens when instead of having one object isolated, we have many objects. Okay, and as you have seen, realistic media like the one we saw. Okay, it's difficult to say what is the scatterer. There are scatterers everywhere at all scales. Okay, but nevertheless, we can extract some meaningful things. So I'm going to show you a thought experiment. No, not a thought experiment. This is what I was showing before. But it's a real numerical experiment. So we are going to take a chunk of media with exponential correlation, okay? And we are going to send a plane wave from below. So the medium we have is a medium with exponential correlation, with correlated fluctuation of density and velocity, periodic boundary conditions on the side here, and absorbing conditions at the top and bottom. And this is done with SPECFEM 2D, so up-to-date numerical software. And this is the work of Malcon. So here is the movie. So you have the plane wave. And you see in the wake of this plane wave, a lot of scattering that develops. I don't know if you've seen it, but I think somewhere here, I don't see it, but there was a very strong scattered wave that was generated. That and we see the effect of the boundary condition. it goes out here, but it comes back here. Okay. So you see, it's extremely complicated, what happens. And we are going to try to make sense of this type of simulation. And so what you see, in fact, the really the most important concept to keep in mind that you have two parts of the wave field. So there is a part of the wave field that propagates in the incident direction. Okay, so there is a part of the wave field which is unscattered, the unscattered component. Okay, so it keeps the initial wave vector during the whole propagation, and this it has a specific name. It's called the coherent wave. Okay, it's coherent because it keeps exactly the phase relation with the incident wave, and it never changes of propagation direction. And on top of that, you see that you have all these diffracted waveforms, so there is energy propagating here in all possible directions, and here it's completely diffuse, okay? And so once a wave escapes the initial propagation direction, it's called incoherent, okay? Yes? Ah, no. So the coherent is unscattered, okay? But what does the attenuation is the interference between the initial plane wave and the wave scattered in the forward direction. And in fact, there is even a celebrated theorem which in fact is related to the properties of the scattering amplitude exactly in the forward direction. Okay, so this is the from the scattering point of view, this is the interference between the forward scattered wave and the incident plane wave that produce what is called the extinction or the attenuation. Okay. But the coherent wave, okay, is the unscattered component. It is the part that is left. Okay. So the effect of the interference. Okay. So I'm going to discuss now the properties of these two part of the wave field. So how do we extract the coherent component? Well, you can easily think of it. The incoherent part has lost the phase relation with the incident wave. Okay, so because it has changed direction. Okay, so it has a different propagation path. Okay, path length. Okay, so different phase, and so the particular phase change will depend on the particular realization of the random medium. Okay, so to access the coherent part, okay, what we are going to do is take an ensemble average of the wave field. That is, we will make many realizations of the random medium, repeat the experiment, and just make a standard average. So let me show you. So this is an example, the type of wave field that we get in a single simulation. So you have the distance, time, distance is here, time. And this is the complex waveform that we get. So here you have the ballistic arrivals. And then here we see at some places, and there is a very strong distortion of the ballistic arrivals. So we see that we have a mix in very close to the ballistic wave. We have a mixture of the incident wave and the scattered wave. Okay, and then because of that, that will produce the attenuation. And so to extract what we call the coherent wave, yes.
The order of magnitude
It's a good question. I don't know. It's probably so. This is rather broadband. I will show you in a later slide. I probably have the answer on a slide later. Okay. But it's a broadband experiment. Huh? We have rather large range of frequencies. So I don't know if this has been filtered or not. Malcolm knows probably. You can ask him. But okay. So here you have this the ballistic part. Okay, and here you have the recognize the coda part. And so by ensemble averaging, you extract the unscattered component, the coherent part of the wave field. Okay. And as you can see, its amplitude decays with distance. And we can, in fact, if we want, verify experimentally by just looking at the log of the amplitude with the distance that the decay is exponential. Okay. And this is what this was already introduced by Jocelyn yesterday. And so this exponential decay has a characteristic scan length that is called the scattering mean free path. Okay. Okay. So the scattering mean free path characterizes the decay of the coherent part of the wave field. Okay. So if this guy decays, that means some energy has gone somewhere. Okay. We cannot lose energy. So of course, where is the energy? It is in the coda. Okay. But if we want to access the coda, it's not sufficient to do the average of the field, because the average of the field removes all these scattered arrivals because they are phase shifted from one realization to the other. And so we have to go to the intensity now. Okay. So this is what I'm going to show you. Yes. Yes. Yeah, in fact, okay, so the mean field, you have here, you have the equation satisfied by the mean field. It's called the Dyson equation. The reason I'm showing this equation is for one reason, is because you see that from its structure, this equation generates a multiple scattering series. So completely formally, you can think of solving this equation. So this is the mean Green's function. Okay, sorry, mean Green's function. Green function is free space. Green function is free space. Here we have what we call the mass operator, but this is something that describes an operator that can describe all the possible scattering interaction. Okay, I'm not going to enter into detail. And here you have the mean Green's function. Okay, so you can think of solving this equation iteratively by plugging G on the right-hand side. Okay, and what this does, it generates a multiple scattering series. You get G0 plus G0 sigma G0 plus G0 sigma G0 sigma G0, etc. And this is the multiple scattering series. And what is very important is that it's really the structure. You cannot decide to truncate the series at, say, order 4. This has catastrophic consequences. It is something that was discovered long ago. This generates what is called secular terms in perturbation theory. Okay. So what is really super important is that we are going to completely simplify this operator, which is quite complicated. In fact, what we do usually, we are going just to consider the independent interaction between objects. Okay. So we will not allow, for example, in the description of the scattering, waves to go from one scatterer to the next one, go back, etc. We are going to consider the scatterer independent from one another. And this approximation, in fact, for many, many cases, it worked extremely well. Okay. So in fact, we are going to simplify this guy, but we are still going to sum the full series. Okay. Okay. So this is important. And so this is the equation that is verified by the mean field. Okay. The Dyson equation. So probably you can see it as probably as an Helmholtz equation with a dissipation term inside. Okay. With a complex wave number. Okay. This is the same thing. Okay. Yes, the answer is yes. Okay, but yeah, but Jocelyn, if you have said something wrong, but I think it's okay. I think you can view it as a Helm you can turn this into a Helmholtz equation with a dissipation term. Okay, but of course it's not dissipation. Huh? This is scattering conversion. Okay, and so with the aid of this Dyson equation, so we can solve it for the simplest approximation of this mass operator, which is the what I explained, the independent scattering approximation. That is, in the multiple scattering series, the waves visit different heterogeneities each time they scatter. So they are not allowed to go back and forth between heterogeneities. And even inside one heterogeneity, we only allow for a double scattering event, so second bound approximation. Okay. First bound approximation gives zero because in one assumption I didn't mention, but all the fields we consider are zero means. So okay, you must go to second order. And so with this Dyson equation, we can compute theoretically the scattering mean free path and compare it to the theory. And okay, I'll let you see. So it's frequency. So I don't know. I cannot answer to your question. Sorry, Thomas. But here you see the range of frequency we cover. Okay. So we have different type of random media with different type of correlation between the velocity and density. But okay, you see the idea. The theory works extremely well. Except maybe when we reach some regime where the scattering starts to be very strong. I think here we are close to the geometric regime. Actually, it's not so much a problem of this equation than the way we solve it, where we do an approximation, we do the Born approximation. But okay, the big idea you can get from this is that we have a good theory to compute the mean free path for sufficiently simple media, but already taking the multiple scattering into account. Okay, and this matches very well with the numerical experiment. Okay, let's go to the mean intensity. So again, the mean intensity and the way we produce it, we have single realization. Okay, so we see they have lots of fluctuation, and in fact we know why. It's because in the CODA, the field is a superposition of many, many waves, so it's a Gaussian field. And so Gaussian field, when you look at the intensity, produces exponential correlation, and exponential fluctuation. And so the variance for this exponential fluctuations, the variance is equal to the mean. So that means you have very large fluctuations, and you see them here. But if we average sufficiently, we get this smooth envelope, okay, where you have here the ballistic peak and then the CODA. Okay. And to describe this mean intensity, as was very nicely explained by Jocelyn yesterday, we have the transport equation. Okay, so Jocelyn explained yesterday that the transport equation, in fact, applies not directly to the intensity we measure, but to what we call the specific intensity, but it's just the intensity as a function of propagation angle, and the way you can define that is through the Wigner transform. I'm not going to enter into that. And so this transport equation has this structure. So I like to view it in this way. So on this side, you have the Corian propagation. Okay. So with the streaming term, which is basically the ray theory, and here you have an attenuation term, which is due to the fact that a wave which propagates in a given direction k, okay, will lose energy to all other directions. And here I have added an additional intrinsic quality factor, which is just the absorption term, okay, that I mentioned in the beginning. Okay. And here I write it in the seismological way. It's not I'm not showing the mean free path here. Okay. Here this quantity is proportional to the inverse mean free path, and this is here just the scattering attenuation, the inverse scattering quality factor. Okay, because seismologists prefer to use quality factor than scattering mean free path. Or sorry, it would be here. This is the scattering mean free time, inverse scattering mean free time. Sorry, the product of omega and inverse scattering q. But okay, so this is just a coherent propagation. So a coherent wave does not propagate eternally, and it loses energy to all other propagation directions, so it attenuates. And here, this integral operator produces the scattering. Okay, so again, you can think of it iteratively. You start from your source, you propagate coherently, okay, to the first scattering event. Then you have this scattering anisotropy here, which in fact is related to the scattering amplitude, and we discussed with all its anisotropy. And we know exactly what this is. This is related to the structure factor, which now is the power spectrum of heterogeneity. You see the analogy. So we know exactly what the scattering anisotropy is for a given type of fluctuation. And so this term here will take energy from direction k prime, which is different from k, and can redistribute it into the direction k. So this is you can view it as an energy balance. Okay. And so if you solve this equation iteratively, you say, okay, I am at the source, I propagate coherently, okay, and the typical propagation distance is a mean free path. I get scattered in a given direction, propagate coherently, get scattered, propagate coherently, etc., etc., and you generate a full multiple scattering series. And you see here some comparison between this numerical simulation, so the fluctuating lines here in red are the mean intensities that we extracted from the spectral element simulation, and in black, a radiative transfer solution with the Monte Carlo simulation for different frequencies. So here we have, in a regime of relative weak scattering, where we have strong ballistic waves, okay? And as we increase the frequency, as we have seen, the scattering becomes stronger and stronger. And here we enter into the diffusive regime, and I think it's quite beautiful. There's really a rather good agreement between this simple theory and the full wave field simulation, and we can cover a whole range of propagation regime from ballistic to here, where you have this characteristic diffusive behavior with a very long rise time of the signal that we see, for example, on the moon. So this is a super interesting tool for our data. One thing that I should mention, which is really important to keep in mind, is that in seismology, we never have access to the coherent field. This is something that I want to insist on. The coherent field is really, for us, a fiction. Because we can never do really the coherent field, to really extract it, you really have to do the ensemble average. We can never do the ensemble average. And even the spatial average won't work. Okay. So in seismology, we are always measuring a mixture of coherent and incoherent. Okay. So there's no way we are going to measure the mean free path by taking the decay of the field. This doesn't work because you are always contaminated by the incoherent part, and this completely changes the behavior. I could say a lot more about that, but this is why, for all the work we do on measuring the scattering attenuation, we always use the transport approach. And I think it does, in my opinion, there's no other way for the moment. Yes. Good question. I don't know. I mean, I would say no, but probably indeed, if your two directions are totally different, then certainly you are going to lose the correlation. Can you do that and make an ensemble average? Yeah, but in seismology, we never have uniform scattering. I mean, there is a lot of non-uniformity of the scattering properties. So I think you're never sure you have the same medium. And I think we never have the same medium. So it's a fiction, the ensemble average in seismology. Still, this I will show you, these transport models are incredibly good to model some of the observation we have with really limited amount of assumption. I will show you that for Mars. And I should really speed up to do that. Okay, diffusion limit, you know there's a diffusion limit. There is another scale length, the transport mean free path. I'm going to skip this, okay? One thing important, so maybe to summarize. One question that I get asked very often is, how you do separate the scattering and absorption, blah, 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 blah. Well, actually, it's in principle, okay, it's not very complicated. Why you can separate scattering and absorption, and I'm going to show you we can even do that with one signal. But the idea is super simple. How you separate scattering from absorption? Well, just because you have different behavior. Sorry, we have different behavior for the ballistic part of the field and the coda. You see that the amplitude. So here, this is the space dimension. So take the Eagle 3, okay, and we are okay. But you see that this guy, okay, I'm simplifying a bit the discussion here, but this guy decays exponentially with a combination of here L, the scattering mean free path, 1 over L, and 1 over the absorption. Okay. So when you are measuring basically the decay of the intensity near the ballistic part, you have access to the sum of scattering and absorption. When you are in the coda, okay, there is, again, it's very simplifying. Let's assume the Earth is homogeneous with scattering everywhere. Then we know in the coda, the decay is purely exponential, and the decay time is just the absorption time, which is just this guy divided by the wave velocity. So if you look at the coda decay, you have access to the absorption. If you look at the decay of the Corian field, you have access to the sum of absorption and scattering. You want to measure two things, you have two independent measurements, so you can separate. It's clear? Yes, 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 for the diffusion. Okay, and then we have the if we are not in the diffusion regime, we can use the radiative transfer equation and we can do the same thing. Taking into account the fact that yeah, this is asymptotic, but this remains the same idea. Okay. I've never been so fast for explaining the separation. Okay, I want to show you some insight stuff and some application to insight. Okay. So this is taken from a paper by the Insight team. Now we have many more data. This is the publication, the first publication of the catalog of seismic events that were reported by Mars Insight. So here on this axis, so vertical axis, you have what we call SOL. So SOL is a day on Mars, okay. And to measure the time, to make it human friendly, we use what is called the LMST, so local mean solar time. So basically, a day on Mars is longer than on Earth, I don't remember exactly. But we cut the day into 24 hours, like on Earth. Okay, so that's convenient because we know where it's the morning, the evening, etc. Here you have these two lines that indicate sunrise and sunset. And here you have the measured PSD on the vertical component of the VBB, the variable broadband seismometer. And as you can see, you have a very strong daily variation of the PSD on Mars. And here you have this period of the day from say sunrise, even before sunrise, to sunset, where we have a huge activity in the atmosphere. The atmosphere of Mars, the pressure is low, but there is a huge amount of turbulence during the day. And so this creates a lot of very strong winds that basically shake the... So have you seen, the seismometer is sitting close to a lander. So the lander, of course, is vibrating. The seismometer is protected by windshield, but it's not perfect also. So all this, all the things that you see here is mostly ambient noise created by the wind, okay? And so all these symbols here are the detected events. And as you can see, we have very, very few detection of seismic events. I'm not saying these are quakes, I say events, okay? But we have very small number of detection reported during the day, and that's just because of the huge amount of noise, okay, related to the wind. But when it's night, very, very rapidly, the wind intensity decreases. It does not completely vanish. We still see some wind, okay? But it's much, much lower, much more quieter. It enters into a laminar regime. And then the noise level drops, and then we can start to listen to Mars and detect some seismic events. So there are the way and the way the Mars Quake Service work, and they have people who get the data in real time, and they basically do spectrograms. They observe the spectrogram and they say, oh, okay, here we have something which is not probably not noise, and okay, this is a seismic event. And this seismic event has been classified with two qualities. One is the bandpass of this seismic event. So we have basically two different families of events, the one which we call LF, low frequency. So basically, these are events whose frequency range goes down to 10 seconds, maybe 20 seconds at maximum, okay? And no energy above 1 second, okay? And the second family are the high frequency family, the one that which I'm going to use to show you something about the scattering. And these events have energy from, say 2 hertz to tens of hertz. Some have energy up to almost the Nyquist of the instrument, 50 hertz. Okay, and then we have subcategories of events, not necessarily need to go into this, but I should mention that we have something super specific to Mars InSight, which is related to some observation, and that I'm going to show it to you later, of a permanent noise at 2.4 Hz. There is a band of noise around 2.4 Hz that is almost permanently excited. You will see it on spectrograms later. We don't know exactly what it is. There are different views on that in the team. My personal view is that it is a resonance of the soil related to the geology. And indeed, you see that this 2.4 Hz resonance is excited by quakes. Okay, but it's debated. So because of this, this is an amplification. There is an amplification of the signals. So there are many, many events that we detect only this frequency band. Okay. Just like you have, basically you amplify the level of the signal, so you can detect many more events in this frequency band. And so we have some specific events which are related to this 2.4 Hz resonance. Okay, and so basically we have everything, now on Mars we have everything that is above 2.4 and below 2.4. So above 2.4 is the high frequency family, below 2.4 is the low frequency. And exceptionally, some events have energy beyond 2.4 and below a few seconds, and these are called the broadband events, but they are very few. Okay. Detected so far, I think with this one, I think more than 2,000, 3,000 events, something like that. And we have another type of event which I'm going to use, which are what we call super high frequency events. So these are events that occur at very specific time of the day. That is, they are concentrated at sunset. Okay, so these are all these events. It's interesting. You can see when I say event, this is the maximum horizontal amplitude, and here it's nanometer per second. Okay, so 5 nanometers per second, but many of them have an amplitude which is below that. So these are extremely tiny events. All the events we detect, we rarely exceed the nanometer per second. It's a few nanometers per second. Okay, and we have many of these super high frequency events, and they present themselves as repeating events, so they are interesting for monitoring application. Super high frequency, it's they don't have energy at 2.4, they have energy from say 5 Hz to okay, whatever you want. Okay. But they are super energetic around 7-9 Hz. We see them very clearly, the very good signal-to-noise ratio, 7-9 Hz. And we have hundreds of these events, and we have now even more. Okay. Okay. This is just to show you the difficulty with the data. So to show the difficulty with the data, showing you a day on Mars. Okay. So this was an exceptional day because we had 4 events. They are here, and they were all detected during the night. But you see the life of a Martian seismologist or seismologist working on Martian data. It's really ugly, and I think some people in the audience had a look at the data, and they will confirm that yes, the data are really ugly. The instruments are really fantastic, but it's the acquisition which is very complicated. Because we have the lander, we are sitting next to a lander. The lander is vibrating, okay? I'm going to show you where. We have a tether, so this is the cable that that connects the lander to the seismometer, okay? So this tether is subject to thermal stresses, okay? So it dilates, contracts, and so this is at the origin of many of these peaks that you have here, which we call glitches, okay? And so these glitches, they show up here, so they produce a lot of this low frequency response. In fact, it excites the impulse response of the instrument. Okay, and some of them have this high frequency precursors. So you have a peak, a very large peak, and then you have the response of the sensor. So we have many of these glitches. Okay, by chance they have sufficiently repeatable waveforms, so we can track them and remove them. Okay, but it's never perfect. We have this beautiful lander mode. We love them. You see that they are modulated by the temperature, okay? So they oscillate during the day. So we have here 1 at 6, 4. And here you have this, what I call this 2.4 Hz resonance, which in fact is excited all the time. That is, even during the day, when you have quiet period, you see this 2.4 Hz resonance. And it's here, and it's in the noise, okay? And what? This? I think this is a broadband injection of noise by the lander. The lander is moving. So, no. Yeah. No. This is super local. Yes, Alexandre. Yeah. Alors, the 2.4 Hz resonance is so is absolutely stable. So people in the team, people were arguing strongly against in favor of the fact that this was not a true resonance. They say, oh, these are the solar panels. Okay, so they decided to check the solar panels. And in fact, so Nicolas has been working a lot on this data, and he showed the amazing stability of this mode. Okay. So when they did a solar panel check, but there was also another. Didn't they hit the solar panels also? Yeah, they plum on the solar panel, and all the modes, it was spectacular. All these modes had a discontinuity. The only thing that remained stable was this guy here. So personally, there are still people in the team who think that this is due to the instrument. Personally, I'm convinced that this is ambient noise, and that we can see it because of this amplification specific. To Insight, okay, but not everybody agrees with me on that. So, so you see the difficult conditions, huh? Yes, this is a vertical, I think. Yeah. And the amplification, what is interesting, the amplification is stronger, and there's an amplification of both vertical and horizontal. It's stronger on the vertical. Okay, and so during this day. We had several events, so a 2.4 Hz event, you see them here, okay? One LF event here, and one very high frequency event, okay? I'm going to show you a bit more what we do with these very high frequency events. Okay, so this is an example. So it's taken now from the work of Sabrina. So this is what a very high frequency event looks like, okay? So we have basically all these events look a bit the same. We have two wave packets. We said P and S, okay, why not? We don't know, but it's totally depolarized, okay? If you take energy ratios, for example, you look at the partitioning between vertical and horizontal, it's super stable, with a lot more energy on the horizontal component, okay? So there's clearly an amplification of the horizontal part of the signal in this frequency range. And you see the duration, they last 10 minutes, okay? So it's quite long duration. Here you have the spectrogram. You see again that we are always contaminated by lots of disturbance, might be glitches. At higher frequency, not showing, but we have yet another big source of disturbance. These are what we call donks. And donks, we think they are cracks occurring in the lander. So we know that these are cracks in the lander because they excite some lander resonances that were seen when the SP sensor and before being deployed on the ground, so we could measure the response of the lander with the SP sensor, not the VBB, it was not possible, and we noted a number of peaks. All the peaks I've shown you, I know it's a lander mode because it was detected on the lander with a level of energy which was considerably higher. So we saw these resonances, and the donks excite very strongly the resonance of the lander, and they are at higher frequencies, 10 hertz and above, but sometimes they can go down, depending on the hour of the day, they can go down to lower frequencies, and they contaminate our signals a lot, and we have many of them, and there are so many that it's really difficult to remove them. They occur in families. We started to do some waveform analysis. But okay, we could still maybe improve that. But for the moment, it's a big nuisance. Okay, so you see the signals are quite ugly. Nevertheless, we can try to model them. Okay, and this was done in the framework of the Sabrina. Obviously, we do. It's very complicated. It's a big equation. No, okay. So what we did? So this is the measured envelope. Okay, so the black line. Okay. And what we just tried to do, we took a homogeneous half space, but elastic, okay, elastic half space. We made some assumption on the on the type of correlation. So we took von Karman, media, different type of correlation, exponential, etc. We tested many of them, okay, and then what we just inverted for are two parameters: the strength of the scattering, okay, so scattering Q if you want, and the strength of the absorption of S wave. And for the P wave, in fact, we don't need to touch anything, because if we fix the correlation, then if you know the scattering of S wave, you know the scattering of all the other all the other type of waves, okay. And for the absorption, we just take the usual QP over QS equals 3 over 4, the ratio of the wave speed squared. That is, you assume that all the dissipation is in shear, okay? Nothing in compressibility. So we use transport equation. Actually, we simplify them. You know that for elastic wave, transport equations show up as a system of 5x5 equation with Stokes parameters. Here, we just throw away the polarization of S wave. And in fact, we don't see any polarization in the signal. And we can check that this gives an excellent approximation. So it's not a big deal. And so we have basically a two-coupled equation for the energy density of P wave and S wave. And basically, we just invert for these two parameters here. Okay? So we fix the correlation. To be clear, we give ourselves a type of correlation. And just we basically change the strength of the perturbation. And we do that for many types of media. And to do the inversion, we do an iterative linearized inversion, because we can compute both the energy envelope. Okay, so this is an example here of the initial model we had. So this is the response we had initially. So we were completely off. Hein? This is the signal is here. And then we compute the partial derivative of the envelope for scattering and absorption. So here, scattering I have amplified so that you can see it. So this is the logarithmic derivative of the energy envelope with respect to the scattering and the scattering strength and the absorption strength. And what is important is that these functions are more or less linearly independent. Because if they were not, we would not be able to do the separation. But because they are linearly independent, we can do the separation with just one envelope. Yeah, thank you, Laurent. Okay, and it's around 7 Hz here. It's around 7 Hz. Yeah. Actually, in fact, when we do one inversion, you do many inversions because the shape of the envelope is not very frequency dependent. So if you take the envelope around 3 Hz, it will look very similar to the one you get at up to 10 Hz. So in fact, with one inversion, you invert everything, you invert all the frequencies, which probably tells us something about the propagation regime. And so, and you see again what I was telling you: the sensitivity to scattering is super concentrated around the ballistic arrivals. Okay, so the message: if you want to know the scattering properties, don't go in the coda. It's a very bad idea. People think, oh, I want to go in the coda because I will learn about scattering. No. In the coda, you will learn about the absorption, not about the scattering. If you want to know the scattering properties, you have to work really close to the ballistic peak, because this is where you have all the, you can sense all the complexity of the scattering. And if you are too far away from your source, okay. If you are more than 1 or 2 min free pass, forget about it. You will not know about the details of the scattering. All you can find is some kind of effective model. And in fact, so here I'm showing you an example of inversion. So we have the starting model. We compute the partial derivative. And we use an algorithm, Levenberg-Marquardt. He updates the model. And in the end, we get this. And I think, wow, it's impressive. To be honest, I was surprised when we saw that. We know nothing, okay? We just take this transport equation and it's able to fit with very little. I mean, we just took standard assumption, we don't do anything fancy, and it reproduces very well the envelope shape. And of course, it's an effective model, and I'm going to show you why I call it effective. I'm going to show you later, okay? And of course, there is a huge trade-off. Because if I change the type of correlation, so if I change the angular dependence of the scattering and all that, the scattering mechanism, I can always find a model that will more or less match this data. But nevertheless, this model has some common property. They all have the same diffusivity. And this is what I show here. So here we have, it's not a joint inversion. We inverted that event by event. So here is the distance, and it's measured in the difference between S and P travel times. Okay, but you can think of distances from, I think the closest event is around 350 kilometers and up to 1,000 something. Okay, we can ask Sabrina, she knows that much more than me. And here, we have converted the scattering into a diffusivity, because on the moon, people use the diffusion model. So in planetary seismology, people like to know the diffusivity, okay? And you see that the diffusivity for events that are further and further away from Mars InSight is increasing, okay? We have the same thing for the Q mu, so the absorption, okay? And here you have what I said, okay? You can find for the same diffusivity, you have a bunch of scattering models. So this is the scattering Q. So this is related to the mean free path, okay? So you have a lot of fluctuations here because, in fact, what you can invert is not so much the scattering mean free path, but what we call the transport mean free path. So the quantity that is in the diffusion constant. Sorry, I'm going very fast here, but okay. The diffusivity is something reliable. Basically, we can have many models with different scattering Q, but the same diffusivity. And what is important is that we do not get a large spread of diffusivities. Okay, we can find many models, but they all have more or less the same diffusivity. I don't know if I'm clear. Okay, so different scattering patterns, same diffusivity, same fit to the data. And the conclusion from that: so first of all, the Q is super high. So if you ask me, at the scale at which we are looking at, we don't see evidence of presence of water or anything like that. But at the scale we are looking at, it might change in the future because we have new data, okay? But I'm not saying more about this. And then we have an obvious decrease of the apparent attenuation with distance. So that's what is obvious also is that the attenuation is stratified, okay? So and this is the topic we are working on now with Sabrina, okay? But these are my main conclusions. Super IQ, so at large scale, little absorption, so probably little dissipation, little water, and evidence for stratification of heterogeneity. So that gives us hope to determine the thickness of the regolith and the porosity. And now I want to go to Nicolas' part, which I think is really nice. I will skip this. Basically, what we do, or maybe I can go very quickly, but it was explained by Michel. We use the idea of monitoring that was developed by Poupinet and then later by many others to try to see if we can see temporal changes on Mars. Okay, and so you know this observation. You know that in California we have repeating earthquakes, and when there is a big earthquake in between two small earthquakes, you have a change in the waveform, and you measure this. And here, this was seen as a time delay that increases in the coda, and this time delay is related to a change of velocity in the medium. Okay, so this is taken from the work of Poupinet, and the interpretation. We know that the effect is increasing in the coda because of their long propagation path. Okay, and the fact that they sample a large volume, so they can sense the changes much more globally than direct wave, and this is the interest of what is called coda wave interferometry. When you don't have earthquakes, you can use ambient noise. You take the correlation. You have the coda of the correlation. And this is an example of what was seen on the moon. So on the moon, this is the work of Eric Larose and Christoph Zenschelfelder. They took ambient noise on the moon, correlated, and they obtained this signal with the ballistic relay wave and the coda. And they did the monitoring, so by repeating this measurement of empirical Green's function every day, and they were able to measure, so these are the data in blue here, they were to measure some delay time that were increasing and decreasing during a full lunation, so these are 29.5 days. And they found out that temporal variation, okay, of the delay time, so basically temporal variation in the velocity, were related to the temperature at the surface. So when the sun rises, the temperature increases very rapidly, and then when the sun sets, you have basically the heat is being transferred back slowly, and so you decay. And you see the correlation between this temperature curve and the delay time. So which means that when you heat up the surface of the moon, you tend to slow down the velocities. Keep this in mind, okay? You heat up on the moon, you slow down the velocity. And the reason for the delay was explained in a paper by Tanimoto, but I'm going to explain it very quickly. Why do we see it with a delay? Because we are sensing the medium with Rayleigh wave, okay? So this is what happens when you apply a temperature perturbation at the surface of the moon, okay? So here you have the temperature at the surface, due to the solar insulation, okay, illumination, sorry. So the temperature rises, decreases, rises again, okay. And as you know, if you take the diffusion equation, you put periodic forcing, what you get is a heat wave. Okay. So this heat wave is very strongly attenuating. It has a penetration depth, which is controlled in fact by the diffusivity, the capacity of the material to transfer the heat at depth. Okay. And so there is both a propagation effect that you see here and a very strong attenuation effect. And now you sense this with these waves, which are Rayleigh waves. So here I'm showing some sensitivity kernel. I think Tanimoto was working directly on the ballistic. He did the monitoring directly using the ballistic wave. So I think these are group velocities here. But you see that these kernels, the most important one is the one for shear wave perturbation, has this large lobe here of sensitivity at depth. So to summarize, the Rayleigh wave, they don't see what happened at the surface, they see what happens at depth. Okay, so they see the past. So this is why you get this large delay, okay, because of this large lobe of sensitivity of the Rayleigh wave. So basically, they sense what happens at this depth. Of course, it depends on the velocity model, the diffusivity, etc. Okay, actually, Tanimoto has a pretty good model of velocity. So he used, in fact, this observation to put constraint on the diffusivity. Okay, but the idea again, now. You have this. You see basically what happens at depth, and so what happens at depth is the past, okay? And so this is why you have this large delay between the surface temperature and the seismic response. Okay, is it clear? The Rayleigh wave see the past. It's a beautiful sentence. Keep it. Okay. Now I'm going to apply the idea of the doublets with the SF events, and so. As I've showed very very quickly, we have many of these SF events, and they occur in clusters, okay. So the repeating events, and we have identified. So Nicolas did that, and he identified several clusters. So the letter C is for the quality. So C is crap, and D is super crap, okay. But these are the waveform of C0. They have been cleaned up a little bit. And I think even if you are not a good seismologist like me, okay, and you don't see anything, but you can still see, I think, directly that there is a stretching of the waveform. See it? Okay, here it's like that, here it's like that. We can measure it, believe me. Okay. And so this stretching of the waveform tells you that there is some evolution of the velocity in the ground. Something you can also see that. You understand soon why I did that. We can also see that in the frequency domain. So when you take one of these waveforms, you Fourier transform it, and you get one of these PSDs. Okay. So these PSDs, the oscillation of the PSD are like the fingerprint of the seismic event. Okay, in the frequency domain. And here we have reported. Here this is the event number. Here it is the PSD, and you see that we find all these crests and troughs. Okay, but the position is changing. And this is a classical thing. If you stretch a signal in the time domain, you compress it in the frequency domain. Okay, and basically, you can retrieve exactly the same apparent changes of velocities from just looking at the compression or dilation of the spectrum in the Fourier domain. Okay, and the reason we do that is you will understand soon. And we have called this a frequency band structure. Okay, because these are bands. Okay, okay, frequency band. We do that for many events, and you see that at some period of the year, you have the velocity that decreases. Then sometimes it's stable, then increases, increases, increases. Here you have the sole number, so you see that we have clearly this is going to draw an evolution over the seasons. What about the noise? The noise, as you know, super difficult because of the Landau modes. Okay, they are here. You have all these Landau modes, these Landau resonances. And we are going to work with these tiny oscillations here. If you have very good eyes, you can maybe see, you see the Landau mode here, okay, that devolves the temperature, but you can also see here some bands, okay. So these bands, we actually saw them by eye, okay, and we decided to say, okay, they seem to deform in a strange way, they move in opposite direction to the Landau modes, and here they are. So we did some signal processing, there's some denoising, but here you can see this oscillation of the PSDs, similar to the oscillation we saw on the event. We are in a similar frequency band. And you see, so these are PSD oscillations, okay, that we have enhanced by signal processing. In the middle, you have a lander mode. And here you see these changes of the central position, of the central frequency of the band. And we have measured this. Okay? And these bands move, maybe it means that the velocity changes. We don't know exactly what produces these bands. Okay? But when we put together what we get from the noise and from the event, this is what we have. So in red, these are what we measured with the seismic event. So we cannot detect them all the year because of the level of noise, but we can use the frequency band structure of the noise, and we produce this type of curve. So here it's around 7-8 hertz, so close to the frequency where we analyzed this super high frequency event in red, and this is a lower frequency band. Okay, so you see that there's a clear pattern over the year. This pattern looks like what? Looks like the temperature. So this is the temperature. So we have different measures of temperature at InSight. So I think in orange, this is the scientific temperature, so temperature measured inside the VBB sphere. Green is the rad temperature, so temperature measured on the ground. And here, black, it's a model that we did ourselves, just taking some estimate of the diffusivity and the ephemerides that you can get from the JPL. So you can compute the solar influx, and you can compute the temperature. Well, it doesn't match too bad what is observed on site. And what you see that there is an obvious correlation between the surface temperature and what we think is the velocity changes inside Mars. And I draw your attention on two things. First, the amplitude of the velocity variation. It's huge. 3%. And in fact, it's even bigger at higher frequencies. But I don't have So it's huge, and it's positively correlated with the temperature. When the temperature increases, the velocity increases, opposite to what we have seen on the Moon. I'm going to go fast. What is the model for this? The thermoelastic stresses. Okay, so it was something that had been proposed some years ago by a guy called Berger to explain the tilts on seismometers. And so what is important to understand is that to produce thermoelastic stresses, you need to have both temporal variation, okay, so seasonal variation, but on top of that, you need to have some lateral variation of the temperature. In this model, this is imposed, okay? We see at the surface, there is a modulation of the temperature at the surface. What creates that? Topography, lateral variation of diffusivity properties, we don't know. But yet, this model, with this ad hoc assumption, allows us to compute thermal stresses. And you can understand what's happening. Suppose you have a temperature which is like that. The part which is at the center is heated very much. It wants to dilate a lot. The part that is here doesn't see its temperature change, doesn't want to move. Okay? So when the temperature is high here, you have high stresses. Okay? The opposite here. Here you are put into compression. Here you are put into extension. Okay, so if you compress, you can imagine you increase the velocity. If you dilate, you are going to decrease the velocity. And so this is the origin of this positive correlation between temperature and velocity. And we could actually do some modeling. So basically using the fact that the Rayleigh waves are the dominant contribution to the wave field, so just like was done by Tanimoto. And this is what we get. So these are the model output. So I'm going to show first the what we get at higher. So it's very simple model, homogeneous all space. Velocities were taken from the one given by the HP cube experiment. And this is what we get. So some really nice aspects is that we don't catch completely the full delay, but clearly now we have a curve that approaches the observed curve. Very important, we reproduce very well the asymmetry. And so on Mars, what is interesting is that it's hot in the winter and cold in the summer. This is due to the eccentricity. So this is the winter time here. Okay, but because Mars is going closer to the sun, the temperature is higher. Okay, so we have this strongly dissymmetric curve, and we reproduce it. We have we are still a little bit lagging in terms of delay. And the most important, maybe the thing that we reproduce the least well, is the frequency dependent, and that suggests some question about the sensitivity. And this was the last part of my talk. About the couple model, do I have 2 minutes? Or zero? Okay, just in 2 minutes. So just to say a word about the phenomenological transport model we developed with Andrés. So for those of you who have good memory, you will recognize it looks very much like the one of Jocelyn, but with some differences. So the in terms of the model, Jocelyn, I think, explained very well what we did. We tweaked the boundary condition to produce a surface wave, okay? And in our model, we have scattering everywhere, okay? So two differences, and we don't have a lower boundary. And I think in that configuration, more or less, Jocelyn, you get an equation where you add the surface wave, okay, with a transfer term to the body waves, which would be something like, well, it would be surface to body here. no, body to surface. So with a transfer term, a loss term to body wave, but no reciprocal conversion, right? So in this model, it's a phenomenological model. Hein? There's no mathematics. Hein? It's a radiative transfer à la Chandrasekhar. we have two big differences. So one was something, we have an energy density which depends on the horizontal propagation direction, like in Jocelyn's model. But in addition to that, we have defined a three-dimensional body wave energy density, okay? So this is not the case in Jocelyn's approach. And in our model, we have a feedback between the body wave and the surface wave. Okay, that is, we can convert surface energy to body energy, okay, but it can convert back. And I just want to show you what it gives for the equipartitioning, and I will stop here. We do get some. I think it's we have to discuss to understand exactly. But what we find for the equipartition between surface and body wave in this model, so these are Monte Carlo simulations, so we know energy is conserved, etc. We control it. We find that there is no such thing as a global equipartition. Okay, what happens is that when you get the multiple scattering, so when body waves are at the surface, we have a conversion term here. In fact, which depends on the depth. As the body wave approaches the surface, because there is this new channel of propagation, which are the surface wave, we get additional conversion. So the body waves are in fact more attenuated as they get close to the surface. So we have a depth dependent scattering mean free path here, mean free time, even though the medium is completely homogeneous. And this is because we see the channel of body waves, so we want to go there as the body wave. So we might convert as we approach to the surface. And of course, we have the reverse process. The surface wave, they can mode convert to body wave, but the body wave, they diffuse away. And the net effect of that is that, these are two curves that correspond to a deep, shallow source, but okay, let's look at the asymptotic behavior. We see that as a consequence of that, we have a permanent, so this is the ratio between the energy carried by surface wave and body wave everywhere. So this is a global global balance, okay? So total energy is conserved. But what happens is that we have a transfer from surface wave to body wave, okay? So surface waves are losing energy, and so we get more and more body wave energy, less and less surface wave energy, and so there is no global equipartition, and we see here that the rate of transfer is T to minus 1/2, probably in the diffusion regime. This is probably related to, we haven't figured out exactly why, but it's something like that related to the diffusion. But now if we, instead of looking everywhere, we take a slab near the surface, we see something different. Then we see an equilibration. And the theoretical value here, we know it. Hein. It's a value we can compute in advance. It's only related to the wave equation we have. And so what we have here is that if we look at we don't look at the energy everywhere, but just at what happens in the layer at the surface, we get a local equipartition. Okay. So it's a little bit different. We still have equipartition, but not everywhere. And one interesting thing is that with that, we can also compute sensitivities. And I will stop here. And so you can see, for example, so the high sensitivity at short time due to surface wave, and then at long time to body wave. And my next talk, I will show you application to data, but I have to stop.